Good afternoon. Good afternoon. Alexa, play my Christian radio. I don't feel so good today, guys. But the Lord is with me. Alexa, play my Christian radio. I have a headache
The
and a
station
half.
Talk Christian on Amazon
But I
Music.
want him still. Come on. And do our praise and worship and our Bible study because no excuses. No excuses.
Sometimes on this journey, I get lost in my mistakes.
Yeah, right.
What looks to me like weakness is a canvas for a strength.
I'm so tired.
And my story isn't over. My story
I feel so weak.
Begun.
Alexa, skip. I need something to jam me up. Or something. Something. I need something. Where are you? This is a good one. Nice and slow. But at least it's praise and worship, right?
His favor be upon you and a thousand generations.
for us. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you. Okay. I have to cut this short because my hands are killing me and my body is really starting to go. And it's really starting to hurt. And that just started happening. So I need to hurry up and get this taken care of. Alexa off. So, oh, that's weird. Okay. All right. So it sounds, feels like the virus is setting in. My fever is going up and I'm starting to feel a lot more like crap. So, although the Lord is with me, doesn't mean we're not going to go through some stuff, okay, kids? I taught you that, like, ages ago. But as long as I can speak, I will continue to do these Bible studies, okay? So, thanks for everyone watching. Hello. Oh, my gosh, my hands. That is so bizarre. Okay. So, all right, let's go this way. So, yesterday, I was doing some Bible study, and it was like, in the back of my Bible, there is a concordance. If you guys don't know what that is, basically, like, this is going to be rough. It's like an index with all these different things. So, you know, the concordance is where you can find things in the back, in the scripture. Like, if you think of a word, you look in there. But in the back of my Bible, this also has index to subjects. So, one of them was alcohol use. And so I decided to do that one because you guys know that mommy always struggles with drinking. And the Lord has been speaking to me a lot about drinking and, you know, not doing it. And a lot of people have been jinxing me with drinking and driving. Not that I get wasted and drink and drive. I don't do that. But, you know, 2-3 drinks is too many if you get caught and then you get a DUI. So I ain't looking for that curse. So I just wanted to go over this probably a little quicker than most times because I know sometimes I last like an hour or half an hour or whatever. But so there are 12 different verses that talk about alcohol use, okay? Now, we've all heard, be of sober mind, right? And it's your responsibility to look that one up. I just know it off the top of my head. Be of sober mind, right? And it tells you to be of sober mind so that you can always have the right words to say to a non-believer or a new believer, okay? One, do you really look like a good Christian if you're sitting there wasted all the time? Not really. People aren't going to really take you seriously and they're not going to take your word seriously. So I wanted to just take a look at this because straight off the bat, alcohol didn't do anybody any good, right? So in Genesis 9:22, oh good, my food's coming soon. 9:22-25. I'm not going to read them all because I don't really feel so good and like I'm going down fast. So what ends up happening is Noah, who is like super devoted to God, he ends up, you know, being blessed by God. He creates a vineyard. And what does he do? Like most people do? He drinks his wine and he gets super drunk. He gets so drunk that he passes out. What ends up happening? Well, he got raped by his grandkid. So, right off the bat, alcohol's not good. So, I'm not sure, you know, I'm not sure if you guys know this, but alcohol has not been a friend to me. And it has made me lose my best friend. I got roofied at a bar that ended up creating, like, I got brain damage because I passed out on the concrete and I bashed my head. So, now I have everlasting brain damage from that. So alcohol is not good. Now, so throughout this, the word, in Leviticus 10:9, it's direct order not to drink. And you must be able to distinguish clean and unclean things. Okay. Then in Esther, the king gets really drunk. he's like, tell my wife to come and be with me. And she's like, nah, bro, I ain't coming. Esther 1:8. So the wife starts lipping it up to the husband because she knows that he's going to act like a jerk. He's probably going to rape her because he's drunk. So she's like, I'm not going to the king. So then the king is like, oh, okay, so she's not going to listen to me. Then she's not going to be the queen anymore. So far in the beginning, all this stuff is not going very well, right? Wine that gladdens. Okay, so then in Proverbs 20:1, wine is a mocker, beer is a brawler. Whoever is led astray by them is not wise. Okay, and how many times have you seen people get really drunk at a bar and they just want to fight? They just want to fight. Or you get drunk. Like, I remember times when I got drunk and I got home and I just was screaming at my kid. Like, and he's like, Ma, why are you so angry? Because beer is a brawler. Okay? So, but then in Joel 1, it says, wake up, you drunkards, and weep. Yeah, because normally after you get drunk, either you're weeping that you have a hangover, you're weeping about the things you said or did the night before because you were drunk and you probably don't even remember. So, and then you're weeping because when you're an alcoholic, you lose everything, okay? You can't stop. Your money is going to the bar instead of your family or things that are better for you. So there are tears that happen when you're a drunkard. But then I was thinking, the first miracle that Jesus did was to create water out of wine, right? Why would he do that? Why would Jesus, and it was actually after the party was like already like pretty much done, the wedding, because what happens in the story, you guys probably know. They're at a wedding, Jesus' mother comes up to him and he's like, yo, we're out of wine. And Jesus is like, what are you bothering me for about this, lady? It's not my time yet to start doing anything. And so she's just like, she tells the servants, do whatever he says. And so the servants are like, all right, what do we do, Jesus? So he says, take those jars of water, big, huge cylinders of water, and fill them with water. So they go, and then he turns it into wine. So it wasn't just like a couple of jugs of wine. It was like a lot of wine, right? So I'm thinking, why on earth would that be the first thing Jesus does? The first miracle. And there were witnesses to the miracle because the servants knew that they poured water in there. But then it ended up being this wonderful wine. He takes it to the bridegroom and he's like, oh, normally people that have weddings, they serve the good stuff first and then the crappy stuff later because nobody's going to notice because they're already drunk. But you have waited to the end to bring out the choice wine. So why would Jesus do that? Because, as with anything, the Lord gives us free will. And he gives us something that could either be used properly, maybe two glasses of wine, and you're done. Maybe one. Because they say a glass of wine a day is good for you, right? Red wine a day is good for your body. And he allows you to make the choice. Are you going to choose something that is going to alter your mind? Or are you going to choose like the straight and narrow? Because God is not going to force you to take the straight and narrow. He's going to give you things to make you make the choice, to see if you're going to make the right choice when the time comes. Are you going to choose gluttony? Or are you going to choose self-discipline? Are you going to choose to be drunk and act the fool? Or are you going to choose, you know, moderation, everything in moderation. So I thought that was so interesting because God is so clever. He's so clever. And I absolutely love that he allows us to stumble and fall before we can stand tall for him, right? So 1 Timothy 3:8 says, not indulging in too much wine. See, it doesn't say, hold on a second, 1 Timothy, oh man, it doesn't say don't do it, but as for like preachers and people of God who are trying to spread the word, you're not supposed to drink. All right, hold on one second, let me find this here. Oh my gosh, I have such a headache, you guys. Holy vey. Oh, give me a sec. Okay, here we go. 3-8. Okay. So this is what the whole bottom line is, okay? So I know that you guys are not looking to be deacons or preachers like I am, but maybe you want to live like them anyway? I don't know. I'm just going with what I learned yesterday. So 1 Timothy 3. Here is a trustworthy saying. If anyone sets his heart on being an overseer, he desires a noble task. Now the overseers must be above reproach, the husband of but one wife, temperate, self-controlled, respectable, hospitable, able to teach, not given to drunkenness, not violent, but gentle, not quarrelsome, and not a lover of money. He must manage his own family well and see that his children obey him with proper respect. If anyone does not know how to manage his own family, how can he take care of God's church? That hit me pretty hard. That hit me so hard. I was like, I get it now. I get it now. I get it. He must not be a recent convert or may become conceited and fall under the same judgment as the devil. He must also have good reputation with outsiders so that he will not fall into disgrace and into the devil's trap. Deacons, likewise, are to be men of worthy respect, sincere, not indulging in too much wine. Again, that's the second time. And not pursuing dishonest gain. He must keep hold of the truth of the faith with a clear conscience. They must first be tested, and then if there is nothing against them, let them serve as deacons. In the same way, their wives are to be women worthy of respect, not malicious talkers, but temperate and trustworthy in everything. A deacon must be a husband of but one wife and must manage his children as household well. Those who have served will gain an excellent standing and great assurance in their faith in Christ Jesus. So, let's look at this. Regardless if you're a deacon or an overseer, these are the we want to like level up. It's time to level up in who we are, right? We want to be better, right? Be the best that we can be for ourselves, for our spouses, for our children, because we are role models for them, for our friends, for our employer, but for God. For God, we are to worry most about what God thinks about us, not anybody else, not anybody else. You're not trying to impress anybody but Jesus, okay? So, we must be above reproach, temperate, self-controlled. That's where it comes in, self-control. Nobody's saying you can't go out and drink, but don't give in to drunkenness. You don't need to do those shots. You don't need that double gin and tonic. You don't need, you know, those shots of so delicious peanut butter whiskey. Trust me, kids, I love alcohol. I am an equal opportunity alcoholic. I have tried every alcohol. I pretty much like them all. Like them all. But I'm over it. I am over walking in darkness because for me, alcohol has never gotten anything. I have not benefited from alcohol. I am not a spokesperson. I don't get paid to drink alcohol. I don't get anything from drinking alcohol except hangovers. So for me, this year, 2021, is going to be a year of purity for me, a year of focusing on my family and on God. So I hope that that's what you're doing and you're seeing the errors of your ways. And maybe this year, your resolution is to drink less. Maybe this is how I'm going to do it. One, I'm not drinking, but if I end up, you know, whatever, I'm really not drinking, but maybe this is how I started reducing my drinking, because I used to drink every single solitary day. You guys could go back 3 years, every single solitary day, and pretty much I'd get drunk. But anyway, now I don't do that, because first off, I feel better. My mind is sharper, and I'm just over it. Costs a lot of money, because I would go out drinking by myself, and that costs a lot of money. So, and this place, this house that I live in now, it's a half an hour, 30 minutes from my friends where they go to drink. So I don't go. So this is a true blessing, this home that I've received to get me to the places that I want to go. But if you have to drink, maybe do this. One for you, one for me. One for you, Jesus, and one for me. So you never go beyond that. Because it's like, oh, okay, one for you, one for me. What are people screaming outside? Kids, guy who doesn't kid. So I hope that helps you. I hope that you continue to realize that God just wants what's best for you. He's not trying to hurt you. It's the devil who is trying to hurt you to convince you to have another, that you can handle it. But guess what, baby? It only takes one time for that cup, for those lights to go on behind you. You're $10,000 broker, and you lost your license for a year, if not two. And they're no joke. They don't have sympathy on drinking and driving, okay? There's no sympathy for people who drink and drive. And there have been people who actually kill other people while drinking and driving, okay? So just don't do it. Make this year a year of good, good decision-making, self-control, and more focus on God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your wisdom. Thank you so much for helping me to see the truth and the errors in my way. Lord, please help me to get over this corona, because I feel like it's going to get bad next 2 days, Father. You know what a baby I am. So please heal me in the name of Jesus. Father, I ask you to be with those who are listening now and later, that you may help them to break those addictions to alcohol, to break the addictions that are holding them back from having a better relationship with you. Lord, we love you, we need you, and we appreciate you. In Jesus' mighty name we pray, amen and amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Amen and amen. Okay, kids, I think I have to go lay down because I don't feel good. And my head is killing me, and I'm hungry, but I don't feel like eating, but my tongue is burning. My tongue is burning. And it looks weird. My tongue is burning and my fever is going up, but the Lord will sustain me. All right, you guys, have a wonderful day. I hope you're all safe, healthy, and surviving. Thanks for watching. And remember, be blessed to be a blessing. Bye. Amen. Love you, Lou. Thanks for watching, everybody. Take care. Bye.